Okay, maybe I'll start with one from the chat. The experiences and confusion I have are when people interpret Jesus' parables in a way to fit their own agenda. I understand there's not one way to interpret these parables, but where do we as a church recognize when the interpretation is contrary to the gospel?
I'll take that one. Given that I spoke briefly on how Catholics interpret the text, one of the main things that we have to consider is the historical context in which the Bible emerged, right? In the Old Testament, we saw that they were written largely in Hebrew and Aramaic, and the New Testament entirely in Greek. Jesus was speaking to a particular time and to a particular people. He uses largely agrarian metaphors that would have been familiar to the people of his time, farming, harvesting, etc. We also have, thank the Lord, an extensive body of commentary from the church on what the meaning of the New Testament is, the meaning of the Old Testament is. And as I mentioned in my talk, as Roman Catholics, we understand that revelation is both scripture and tradition. So if we encounter an interpretation that is blatantly contrary to our tradition, automatically we should be a little suspect of that, right? We're very fortunate in that respect. If there's a tradition, right, that does not have an extensive body of commentary or some kind of authority, I would imagine it's a lot easier to fall into the temptation to read the words on the page too literally and to bend them in our own minds to suit our agenda. So that's what I would respond to that question.
I would also, thank you, mm-hmm. I would also add that interpretation in our tradition is a community endeavor. So there's no single individual, and I think Antonio pointed that out. He said there's no single time in which the definitive interpretation was fixed, and there's neither a single individual reading that can be enthroned as the definitive interpretation. So communal discernment, what we're doing here, our discussion, and what the church does, which is also consider together different readings that emerge within its diverse communities, and then sift them through, and if necessary, warn against readings that would hurt our faith or interpretation of the text. The Constitution Dei Verbum of Vatican II Council states that basically all research into possible meanings of scriptural text is also forwarded to the authority of the church, which then can mature its own judgment on it. So it's a process of discernment, communal, and not just a one shot right or wrong that we're caught in, which means that also asks patience of us. Because that means that we need to allow time for that discernment process to take place.
Can I say a little bit about scripture itself provides some interesting tips and guidelines for how to do good interpretation? So I've been very much buried in the world of Paul lately, and some of the things that Paul and Jesus say are judge something by its fruits. Which interpretations are having a good outcome for building up the community? Which interpretations are leading to major divisions? This might be one aspect of discernment, one kind of sign that your interpretation is in line with teachings of the church that are going to build up to create opportunities for justice and peace, or interpretations that are going to lead you down a path that is divisive and hurtful. It's not the only criterion, but it's one.
So based on...
Oh, wait, do we want to grab a mic so that you're recorded?
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, I have a question. So in regards to racism, what is the church's stance on Black Lives Matter? And as a Catholic, what is your active role? What is a Catholic's active role in fighting against racism?
So I would have to look up exactly what the church has said about Black Lives Matter, but there's certainly been positive affirmation of the protests that were happening and the right of people to protest on behalf of social justice and the value of Black lives. Some of those statements came in the form of like letters and proclamations from the USCCB, which is the Catholic bishops in the United States. And there have been a lot of really excellent writings by Black priests and lay people in the Catholic Church who are commenting on Catholic social teaching, especially liberation theology, and the idea of if you have a preferential option for the poor, these are reaching out to those who are most on the margins, perhaps because they've been placed there by the majority of society. And so there are a number of scholars who have made a parallel or analogous argument about Black Lives Matter and the importance of a preferential option for those who are experiencing marginalization in society. So that's one.
Thank you, Dr. Gray. And just to add to that, what Dr. Gray said, my own observation. And that will begin by the intro made by Dr. Gray. That was a beautiful story about how slavery was handled by basing on scriptures, which is a misuse of scripture. And basically, the church would say, we have to follow the scripture. We have to base our service, our lives on scripture. And what we have seen in that story is misuse of scripture. And that reminded me to go back to my culture and what was in my culture related to that. And I remembered one story. Genesis, that is Deuteronomy 25:5-10 says, if a person died without leaving a son, let his wife be to his brother, so that he can leave a son to his brother. So in our tradition, widows normally go to, what do you call, brother-in-law?
Brother-in-law,
yeah. Brother-in-law, and that brother will have a son or a daughter from that woman, then that's all. You will not continue with her. And that's painful, you know, how much that woman will be under pain. There is a little bit protection for that woman, but it's slavery. She is becoming under the slave of that family. They are trying to have a son from her, a daughter from her, so that she may not go to others, but she will remain in that house so that she can serve them. And this is, this has taken a lot of issue in our family, in our tradition, and the church or the bishops of that local area has discussed on that matter, and it was a painful journey, but finally they managed to eradicate that form of slavery. So that is one form of reaction from the church or response from the church. We have to base our service on the gospel, and the gospel is the gospel of freedom, the gospel of love.
I might also comment that when we say what is the church's response, right? We might be asking or thinking about, okay, what's an official church document, right? What's an I haven't seen an encyclical from Pope Francis on Black Lives Matter or something like that, right? But the institutional bounds of the church are not the entirety of the church, right? We here are the church. And if we say that Black Lives Matter, then Black Lives Matter, and that is the church saying that Black Lives Matter.
I was curious how in non-Christian and in non-Islamic cultures that had slavery in the past, did their religion, was that ever used to try to justify having slavery?
I guess the example that comes immediately to mind is the caste system reinforced by Hindu religion. Mm-hmm. I don't know if others have additional examples. I think a lot of times their religion is one aspect of culture. And so just as religion and its texts and its practices can shape a community, often it goes in reverse as well. So if slavery is an aspect of culture and you are constructing as a community a story about what your community looks like, it's going to include things that reflect the reality that slavery is an institution.
I would add that When such injustices as slavery become institutionalized, it's because somehow they fit into a system, and more often than not, it's the economical system. Mm-hmm. So society is working that way to ensure that productivity is high, costs are low, and that we get all the advantages of, or that a group gets the advantages of the wealth available, and in some insidious way, slavery is very much present per se today, but also under other disguise, because of extremely low wages in other countries. Where many of the objects we enjoy buying at a very low price are produced. So in a sense, even if we state we are against slavery, somehow we're caught within it, even unaware of it, by purchasing again things that coffee should cost more than a CD. And it's not. It doesn't. So in a sense, our whole economical system, the way we live in the Occidental world, presupposes a disregard or a comfortable forgetfulness about the labor conditions in other parts of the world, which eventually that turns about to be the same thing, slavery.
And I'd say even in the United States with wage slavery and especially low wages or no wages for those who are incarcerated and are performing labor producing products that some of the rest of us enjoy.
And I might add, thank you, Dr. Luna and Dr. Gray. The United States has a unique relationship with slavery, right? Chattel slavery in the United States was not like slavery that Romans instituted, Greeks instituted, right? That had no respect for someone's color, right? Chattel slavery was explicitly about race. It brought people from their homeland and purposely destroyed their culture and cultural identity. The other thing that we forget too often is that slavery is not illegal in the United States. It's illegal in the vast majority of instances, but the 13th Amendment to the Constitution explicitly allows slavery as a punishment for the imprisoned. And it's a remarkable coincidence that those who are imprisoned happen to be, the vast majority of them, the same race as those who were enslaved. So, yeah.
Can you elaborate on that? What should we do? Like, what can we start doing to change things?
That's a good question.
Yeah, the question was, can you elaborate that on what should we do and what can we do to change things? Being preserved for posterity.
I feel like slavery is so engraved in our culture, from the color of our skin to even our sexes. I know we'll get to the sexism later panel, but it's so detailed, like even with police brutality and within our justice system. And I just feel like, as a church, what should we do? And I guess if you could deliberate, and if we're even as individuals, like what can we do to start changing things? Whoever wants this.
I think at this age, we are seeing a new and hopeful side in knowing where is our problem and from where it is coming. And special awareness on like structural violence, it's a good sign. We are able to realize where is this issue lies. So if we are able to realize that issue, so we are on halfway to solve the problem. What was the point I was thinking? That is a good sign on our awareness and to see where our problem lies. I think I forgot the point I want to mention. But there are a lot of new signs, positive signs of our time, which addresses our problems.
And I feel like these questions are tough because I, as a Catholic person who studies the Bible, I do want to look to the Bible for some possible guidance. Okay. And I think, I love gospel stories, I study the New Testament, and what I see in the model of Jesus is someone who goes to individuals in the community, puts himself in communion with those who are on the margins. And so I think that reinforces for me that there's no act that's too small. Okay. Especially in the face of something that is a huge systemic injustice, it can feel paralyzing. But Jesus's work is a nice reminder that me going and having dinner with people who don't look like me, who've grown up in an experience that is not my own, and listening and being present, and then standing in solidarity with people is a worthwhile act.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's one, it's not a satisfactory answer, but it's a beginning.
Yeah, it's a start.
Yeah.
Yeah, the point I was thinking to mention is that I remember the movies that I have seen a couple of months ago, The Circle. Mm-hmm. So in that movie I learned how our world is moving toward this transparency. So that transparency, unveils all the hidden agendas which keeps people under slavery. And that's one point. Also, another good point which I can say as a sign of our time, positive sign of our time, is the awareness of the young generation to oppose that form of life. Mm-hmm. It was taken for granted. People were not aware how to respond to that kind of situation. But when I see this young generation, violently reacting on that situation, that's also a good positive sign for me.
That's true, you're right.
You want this?
Thank you. You had the right answer. I know we always ask, what can we do, or how can we change things? And it always seems like it's, what can they do to help the situation, not what I can do to help the situation. And sometimes people just need, like you were saying, to go out there and meet them and just give them hope. It's up to them. It's up to all, to the individual to want to change. And all they need sometimes is a little handout. They don't need you to run their life for them. And I think sometimes that's what we think we need to do, is run their life for them. But just to give them that encouragement, that hope, that they can make a change, that they can move forward. That's probably the biggest bridge we can give them, is to have that common one-on-one with them, that they are not alone. And just to hear us say here, well, we'll pray for them, but they don't know that we're praying for them. They don't know that I'm touching them. I think we need touch. We need that one-on-one human connection that we've lost with social media, with Facebook, with everything. And people need to see and feel that they are loved, and we need to always pray for those that have no one to pray for them. And so it's so easy to say, well, somebody will take care of it. I'll just stay home and I'll pray for them here. But it's uncomfortable to move out of our comfort zone to be out there. And that's the hardest part. And the hardest part of doing anything is to start. And so there's a lot of work to do, but we just need to get up and move.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you. I would like to add that systems like slavery, like social injustice that are encrusted in our society and even in engraved or consecrated in the Constitution stand there because of implicit social consent, and basically based on tradition and prejudice. So one small thing we can do, I mean, we cannot change an amendment from one day to the other, but for that amendment eventually to be changed, that means that at the base, voters need to change their minds. And what we can do as individuals is zero tolerance with prejudice. Because, you know, sometimes I don't like conflict. And, you know, in family and whatever, and so you let go the sarcastic comment or the pun or the joke or the idea, and every single wrongdoing comment that goes by just reaffirms the prejudice, the social prejudice, transmits it to the next generation, and makes it all the more difficult eventually to change our institutions, our laws, our ways of behaving. So I would say that one thing we can do is to be that change in our own social circles, friends, family, and not tolerate the preservation of prejudice, but to challenge it, to be bold like Jesus, and to challenge it face to face, so that eventually the revolution takes place. Because it's not anymore a given. It is not anymore something that everybody says so or everybody thinks so. So.
I had a coworker who was from Turkey, and she told me that the Noah's Ark was there, and I've also read other people tell me that my former coworker was totally wrong. And I was just wondering if you could tell me, if you guys could elaborate a little bit about the earliest known archaeological evidence of different things that happened in the church. Because like on another related topic, I remember hearing controversy about whether or not like the city walls of Jericho actually fell.
I'm going to take a stab at this, because one of the classes that I was very lucky to take in college was an archaeology class, but it was also taught by a professor who was in the religion department and worked on the Bible. So we got a lot of little stories. And at the risk of being deeply disappointing, one of the things that he told us about was that when people are writing grants to get funding for archaeological projects, and they want to dig in a specific area and find out about the history of that place, if you can attach your project to a biblical story, a story from the classical world, or like say this is where the city of Troy was, right? If you can attach it to that, you might capture the attention of some donors who want to give you money. And then you go there and you dig and you find things out that are really useful, but sometimes the projects are billed as we're going to go dig for Noah's Ark, and it may not actually be what the archaeologists are trying to find. Our Hebrew Bible scholars may actually know more than I do on this, but I believe that some of the earliest material we have is inscriptions that say there were groups of Jewish people or Hebrews who worshiped this certain god and that they were in an area. I also know that in Jerusalem there is some evidence perhaps for the time of David, but I'm not sure of too much a lot earlier.
Yes, thank you, Dr. Gray. That's very good advice. I would add that we have to be very wary about biblical archaeology the more we go into the past. And as Professor Hanneken or Dr. First could talk us or share with us plainly. The early stories, you know, are soaked in myth, and so Genesis 1-11. Is really not something that we can do actually, you know, historical digging in the sense of archaeological digging for. And if you only watch for the span of living of the characters, you're going to see that declining life expectancy from 700 or 800 years that lived, I don't know, Adam, or until you get to Abraham, in Genesis 12, where you have something more of a lifespan that we know about. So there's something purposeful written in those Genesis stories, within which the flawed story is. That is self-conscious that this is a story that is being told with a message, but not necessarily something that, you know, we could detect where the flood happened and where the ark is. We know for a fact that there's been other flood myths in the ancient Near East that were written before Genesis and that inspired Genesis in its writing. So we would be misguided into thinking, you know, we can dig up and find and that is I would say not really, we would be missing the point of the story by doing that. So it's we were asking before, well, how do we know we're not doing a correct reading? Well, that when we're not following the grammar of the text, the literary genre of the text, we're already, you know, missing the point.